it should be. All longing satisfied, and seeing you, our Christ. There'll be no tears, no pain, for we will never die. Before the throne we'll stand, crying worthy is the Lamb. There'll be new joy, new life, the world as it should be. All longing satisfied, and seeing you, our Christ. There'll be no tears, no pain, will never die. Before the throne we'll stand, crying worthy is the Lamb. Thank you, Lord. This is our Savior, reigning forever. He'll return and make all things new. Our future with Jesus forever, where death is no more, you'll make all things new. And this is our Savior, reigning forever. You'll return and make all things new. And this is our future with Jesus forever, where death is no more, you'll make all things new.
Well, good morning, everybody. Can you believe it's Friday already? Unbelievable, isn't it? The week just absolutely flies through, but we are very much praying for you that what you have learned and heard and taken in this week will live long in your life, in your family, in your church, and as you go out to be God's image bearer in the world. Welcome to all of you in the tent this morning. Welcome to all of you as well at our relay. Thank you so much for joining with us, being part of this week, and those listening online as well. Hope you felt part of this tent, but also remember you'd be welcome to come here in person. And please, as you would go home today, we pray that you'd all have great safe travels, and please be praying for us. There's two more weeks of convention and folks traveling today to various parts of the country, so just be praying that God would do his work in us and that many churches and God's kingdom work in this nation and beyond will be thoroughly blessed for what's been happening here at Keswick. If you're getting in touch through social media, let's remember hashtag KesCon23. Thank you for all the encouragements that have been coming in. Let's keep them coming. And maybe just share a one-line reflection. What has this week meant to you? What's God said to you this week? That means so much to us as organizers, to hear how God has been speaking into your life specifically. So, hashtag KesCon23. As a call to worship today, I was thinking of Ephesians 2. We've been singing words to that effect. Ephesians 2 ends with the idea that Jesus, by his cross, has brought together a Jew and Gentile to be one people, one new human race. And Paul says, Ephesians 2:19, consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus Christ himself as the chief cornerstone. 1 Peter was telling us about that as well. In him, in Christ, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. We are priests in God's holy temple. And in Christ, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by His Spirit. We are a dwelling in which God lives by His Spirit. And we're going to sing in just a couple of moments, as God's temple, raising our worship to heaven. Let me pray as we begin our session today. Heavenly Father, thank you for all that you have done among us this week. And thank you for the joy that as image bearers, as divine priests today, fulfilling this priestly calling in our lives every day, Father, may we get the sense as we sing together and join heaven in heaven's praises to your darling Son. Father, help us to understand our priestly work and our worship. Thank you that we worship now in song with our lips, but then we go from here and worship with our lives. And may our lips and lives in tandem raise praise to the glory of your name as you build us as living stones into this holy temple built on Jesus Christ, the precious cornerstone. May our lives be built on him. May our churches be built on him, our families. Lord, make him the center of all we say and do and think. We ask this for your glory. Amen. Let's stand together and sing as a holy temple.
So we are all one in Christ Jesus. What a wonderful motto, what a wonderful truth. Let's sing of our unity in Christ.
Sister, let me wipe your tears. Brother, let me bear your fears. Come on, every daughter, every son. Let us walk in love, for we are one. Though we walk a long and broken road, we are here to bear each other's load. And forgive as you've forgiven us. Let us walk in love, for we are one. We are one in the Father's love. We are every tribe and every tongue. We are found in the risen Son. We are bound together by His blood. Let us walk in love, for we are one. There's a love that conquers all divides. There's a love that paid the greatest price. For the battle over death is won. Now alive in Christ we live as one. We are one in the Father's love. We of every tribe and every tongue. We are found in the risen Son. We are bound together by His blood. Let us walk in love, for we are one. On the day you come to call us home, with the multitude before the throne, now with all the saints who've overcome, for eternity we'll sing as one. We are one in the Father's love. We of every tribe and every tongue. We are found in the risen Son. We are bound together by His blood. us walk in love, for we are
Please take your seats, and thank you so much to Emu again for leading us so beautifully in our worship. Yeah, indeed. Thank you to you as well as we come to the end of our week for all that you have given financially. We used to pass big buckets around the room. We don't see it so visibly now, but thank you for those of you that have gone and picked up forms or given contactless. This is part of our worship as well, and here's a reflection from 1 Chronicles 29. David praised the Lord in front of the whole community. He said, "Lord, we give you praise. You are the God of our father Israel. We give you praise forever and ever. Everything in heaven and on earth belongs to you. So we give out of what God has given us. Lord, the kingdom belongs to you. You are honored as the one who rules over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things." And it's in that context that we give. So thank you so much for what you have given so far financially to God's work. And no penny that you have given will be lost, and it will count for eternity. So thank you so much. Now, we can't hold him back. It's Jonathan Carswell on books.
Morning, everybody. Morning. Where's the young man with the birthday? Is it somewhere along here? Well, just let me say to your friends and family, a book is a great birthday present. I'll just say that. Now, did I mention that there's a great biography as well? I perhaps mentioned that one last night. Anyway, this morning I want to highlight some books that are going to help us think through a little bit further on what it is to be human, and particularly about gender and sexuality. And let me just say, what we've tried to do as we make these recommendations is get people who hold to Scripture and are wrestling with these things. Now, you'll see in a minute, a couple of these books are perhaps taking slightly different angles, positions on it, but still seeking to hold to God's Word. And so as we look at them, come and talk to us, because we can perhaps help you with some of the nuances, the differences that they pick out. But let me highlight again Ros Clark's book, Human. I think if you're wanting a starting place, this is the one to get hold of, as she walks through it in a very helpful, biblical, and practical way. And as we've mentioned, you can get that as part of the pack, the Keswick pack that we've mentioned, or you can buy it individually as well. Now, Sam Allberry, who we've enjoyed this week in his ministry, his book, What God Has to Say About Our Bodies, is again helping us think through, okay, what does Scripture teach? If Scripture is where we start and end, what does the Bible say? And he goes through it in three sections: created, and then broken, and then restored. And it helpfully walks us through those stages. And again, in our conversations, as we're talking with perhaps friends, neighbors, colleagues who are asking us, well, as a Christian, what is it that you stand for? And is that really palatable? Sam's book's going to help us have that framework to guide our conversations. If you want to go a little bit deeper, but not so deep that it's kind of beyond an academic, I've really appreciated this book by Kelly Capick. It's called You're Only Human. What I like about what he does is his phrases, his turns of phrase, are just perhaps slightly different, a bit more creative perhaps, but making the same point. But he's looking at the limitations that we have as humans and why it's a really good thing. Maybe you're frustrated that your body doesn't do quite what you'd like it to do or what it used to be able to do. Those limitations actually help us see and understand who God is and who we are. And he really helpfully takes us to Scripture and shows us why that's a good thing. And then two books on sexuality and particularly homosexuality. Preston Sprinkle's book, Embodied, and Matthew Roberts' new book, Pride. As I say, they take slightly different angles, slightly different conclusions, but within the framework of Scripture, and apply it holding to Scripture. I think Matthew's book, the first half, is quite heavy, and you might want to give up on it. But in the second half, he asks some really good and helpful questions to think through. You may not have the same conclusion that he comes to, but these questions will help us and strengthen us as we're seeking to do what is right in God's eyes, even when the world is saying, do your own thing. So come and talk to us. We want to help serve you. Even on this last day, get something good that will point you to Jesus. And as you're reading it throughout the year, we'll be praying it might just impact and change your life. Thanks.
Now, you can quite literally take the convention home with you. You can order convention talks to take them home. Talks are all labeled and edited to be convenient for following easily, watching from home or with your church with no need for the internet. They're a great keepsake or gift for those who can't be in Keswick this year. And all proceeds will go to support Keswick Ministries, so it's a good way of giving back and getting something worthwhile for yourself as well. So you can order online now by going to keswickministries.org/shop or the convention reception. You can also, of course, catch up on everything on YouTube, our podcasts, our talks library online. Have a good look through the Keswick website. Talks from this convention and previous years. Loads of resources there, a resource that keeps on giving throughout the year. And then we're already thinking forward to next year, Keswick 2024. Please join us, Keswick Convention 2024, as we explore the glorious theme of resurrection. Promises to be fascinating. Week one, our speaker will be David Gibson. Week two, Andrew Satch. And week three, Vaughan Roberts. So another rich feast for you next year. Also, we love our volunteers. We're so grateful for our volunteers. Volunteer at the 2024 convention. Convention takes 650 volunteer roles each year to support the event in a variety of ways. And it's a great time to join with others on a team for a week or more. You can serve God's mission at convention, and you can be encouraged by spending time with God's people, seeing God's word at work. You can also volunteer all year round with us. And if you're a local at Keswick or you'd be interested in joining us for a week, perhaps helping look after the pencil factory site, which takes a lot of looking after, you can find out more about this after this meeting by visiting the Keswick Ministries stand in base camp or picking up a volunteer card on your way out of the main tent. Now, as we mentioned base camp, please go and visit there again today. Look at all the missionary stalls around there. So much to be thinking about, to be praying about. So please go and visit. Now, it's my great pleasure to thank now formally on behalf of all of us Sam Allberry for what he has given us this week. Sam, thank you so much for the winsome way in which you have spoken. You have really uncovered our hearts by God's word through his spirit, but you've done it in a gentle way, and you've also really encouraged us. We are loved by the Father, so thank you so much for all that you have done. Just to say, if you're a speaker and you make it sound as easy as Sam makes it sound at the front, you can tell the hard work that's been done from home. The harder work that's done from home means you make it sound easy from the front. So thank you, Sam, for all that you have done and your God in this. And may God bless you as you go back to Nashville. I know you will miss the rain. I know you will, but it'll be okay. You can come back again. Now, let's open our Bibles. 1 John 5, we're going to finish this lovely little letter. And our reader this morning is Bridget Robson, who is wife of James Robson. So she's the one who keeps James on the straight and narrow. We're so grateful for this godly couple who have served us for 7 years now. And we want to be praying for them as they move on as well to Oak Hill. But for now, Bridget is going to read 1 John 5. She's going to read the whole of the chapter. So come ahead, Bridget.
So we're reading from 1 John chapter 5, starting at verse 1. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. By this, we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies. Because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood. And these three agree. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God that he has borne concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God, has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony, that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever way we ask, we know that we have the requests that we have asked of him. If anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask, and God will give him life to those who commit sins that do not lead to death. There is sin that leads to death. I do not say that one should pray about that. All wrongdoing is sin, but there is sin that does not lead to death. We know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning, but he who was born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch him. We know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, good morning again, beloved in the Lord. It is good to be with you. It has been a joy and a privilege to open God's word with you these mornings. I have an older brother, and just occasionally in my childhood, that was a useful thing. He was at the same secondary school as me. He was a couple of years above me, and that was useful. It didn't hurt having a bunch of guys you knew who were 2 years older. That offered a certain level of protection. But it was particularly useful because it turned out our third year physics exam, I don't know what that is today, year something else, but when I was there, year three physics exam, it turns out that exam hadn't changed for a few years. And my brother could still remember some of the questions, and he decided to help me and said, Sam, there is a question everyone gets wrong on that exam, and I can remember exactly what the answer is, and this is the question, and this is what the answer is. And I was like, oh, okay. That doesn't sound like the right answer, but okay, fine, great. Good to have that intel. So I went into the exam, and there was that question. So I thought, okay, well, I know the answer. I've got the scoop.
So I selected the answer that I was told was the right one. And the teacher who was invigilating that exam, who was overseeing us, just happened to be walking past my desk as I selected that particular answer. And he stopped and he looked down at my desk and he said, "Are you sure?" Now, he was a PE teacher. And I don't want to disparage any PE teachers in the room, but when your scientific acumen is being questioned by a PE teacher, it's probably time to rethink. But I thought, no, my brother has told me, so I said, no, I'm good. And eventually we piled out of the exam, and I was saying, hey, that question, you know, I know what the answer is, and it's, you know, my brother told me, and this is the answer. Well, when the results came back, I found out I was wrong. And my brother still maintains that it was a genuine mistake on his part. We're not, the jury is still undecided on that. But I mention all of that partly to embarrass my brother, and that itself is reason enough to do so, but also because it is common for people today to say something like, it's good to have faith. Everyone needs to have faith in something. It doesn't matter what that is. As long as you have faith, that's the thing that counts. And my dear brother, if he's taught me nothing else, and I like to think he's taught me nothing else, has shown me that actually there is such a thing as misplaced faith. Well, we are coming to the final sections of John's letter. He's beginning to tie things together. And just as yesterday, we were looking at the difference between genuine spirituality and synthetic spirituality, genuine love and synthetic love. Today, we're thinking about genuine faith, genuine belief, and synthetic belief. So we're going to think about this in three ways. We're going to think about the sign that it's real, the evidence our belief is based on, and the assurance it leads to. So as we think about our faith in Christ, firstly, we're going to see from verses 1 to 5, the sign that our faith is real. John has been giving us these tests that we've gone through throughout the letter, each time giving us a slightly different perspective on it. And what he does now in these first five verses is he binds these three tests, remember, belief, obedience, and love, he binds them together. So we begin with belief in verse 1. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. Being born again means we believe. It's not that we believe and God therefore gives us new birth as a reward. We can only believe because he's given us new birth. We need to be brought alive in order to be able to believe. But he immediately shows us that belief is connected to love. Everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. When we've been born of God, we love him. We begin to see him as he truly is. We see his beauty, his glory. We love him. And John says, and if you love the Father, you love whoever has been born of him. We also find ourselves now with a love of those who belong to him. It is hard to love someone if you hate whoever has been born of them. So some dear friends of mine back home, Connor and Crystal, just had their first baby, a little girl, and they were excited for me to come round and meet her, so I did, and we had a lovely time. She's beautiful. It was good to meet her. Now, imagine at the end of that evening of being with them and of meeting their baby, imagine at the end of that evening as I left, imagine I said to them, listen, it's so good to see you both. I really do love you both. You're such dear friends of mine. Oh, I hate your baby, by the way. Ridiculous, you know, what an annoying baby. But I love you guys. Hate your baby. They would wonder if I really was their friend. And they'd be right to wonder. And similarly, if we love God, we don't hate those who've been born of him. We love those who've been born of him. So belief, love, and then obedience. Verse 2, by this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. Now, it makes sense. The first part makes sense. We think, yes, we know we love the children of God when we love God, because the children of God are children of God. And so our love for him and our love for them go together. But it's fascinating that John says, by this we know we love the children of God when we obey God's commandments. I can't love my brothers and sisters without being obedient to God. Partly because God commands me to love them, so I'm obeying God by loving them. But more than that, I am loving them well when I am walking in obedience to God. In other words, I will never be loving others well if I'm not walking in obedience to God. There are two wonderful women at my church who, for many years, were a couple. They were a lesbian couple for about 15 years or so. They lived at that time down in Alabama. They had a daughter, and one of them adopted another girl, so there were four of them. And several years ago, over a period of some months, the Lord brought both of these women to faith in Christ. As it happens, one of these women is my pastor's mother-in-law from an earlier marriage. And so as they came to faith, she phoned up my pastor and his wife and said, we've become Christians. And we want to come back to church, and we're thinking maybe we should come and move up to Nashville and join your church. You're the only church we actually know. And my pastor and his wife were thrilled and said, that's wonderful, we'd love to have you. And they said to my pastor and his wife, but I mean, here's the four of us, how does this work? We're followers of Jesus now, how do we do this? And my pastor said, why don't you come and live with us? And we'll figure it out together. Prior to being a pastor, he'd been in the construction business, so he built some extra rooms onto the house, built some extra bedrooms and some more space. So the four of them came and moved in with him and his family, and they began their journey with Jesus. These two women are great friends of mine. I remember meeting up with them a few months after they had moved, and I said, listen, you've been a Christian a few months now, however long it's been. I said, do you miss being a couple? Yeah, you were a couple for 15 years, and now, in the world's eyes, you're just good friends. Do you miss being a couple? And they said, we are so much closer as sisters in Christ than we ever were as lovers. God is love. And so when we live in obedience to God, we are actually finding better ways to love one another. The world will look at my two friends and say, well, they've gone from a higher form of love to a lower form of love, from romantic love to friendship love. They would say, no, we've gone from synthetic, disobedient love to real love. Because we love one another best when we're walking in obedience to God. Verse 3, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. It's an expression of our love for God that we walk in obedience to him. And here's what we begin to realize. As we walk in obedience to God, it's not always easy. Sometimes it's difficult. We're denying self and taking up our cross as we go in his ways. But the more we walk in God's ways and live in obedience to his commandments, the more we realize they're not burdensome. They're not easy, but they're not burdensome. They're good. The more we set ourselves to live as God has designed us to live, we see the goodness of his ways, and we begin to find ourselves thinking, yeah, I can see why God has commanded this. This is the right way to live. I'm not going against the grain of who God has made me to be. I'm actually going with the grain. by obeying him. And we remember those precious words of Jesus from Matthew chapter 11. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. When we live in obedience to God, we realize God's ways are not inhumane. God is not giving us too much. No, verse 3, his commandments are not burdensome. So we see that these three tests go together. I've given the heading for these verses, the sign our faith is real, because the sign is that we have the presence of those three things together, belief, love, and obedience. If we think we have any of those things without the others, we don't have them at all. Those three things are distinguishable, but they're not separable. And John goes on to say that as we see the sign of those three things in ourselves, we can have assurance because, verse 4, everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And John so wants us to see this point, he uses the word overcome like five times. Everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Sorry, I can't count. He says it three times. The world is a daunting place to be a Christian. There are our own sinful inclinations that we know so easily go after things that are not right. There's pressures and temptations around us. But if our trust is in Jesus, we will overcome. We can be assured of that because the victory has already overcome the world. In verse 4, Jesus has already overcome the world himself. I'm sure the most famous logo in the world is the Nike swoosh. And whoever came up with that was not paid enough money because that has been an extraordinarily successful logo. And Nike, it turns out, was the Greek goddess of victory. And so the word Nike means overcome. So next time you see the Nike logo on any piece of footwear or any clothing, remember to yourself that through faith in Christ, we overcome the world. So firstly, the sign our faith is real is the presence of belief, obedience, and love. Secondly, verses 6 to 12, we see the evidence our faith is based on. Faith in Jesus matters. It matters that our faith is in the right thing. So why should we believe in Jesus? The Bible never speaks of faith being blind faith. Faith may be in something we can't see, but we have reasons for putting our faith in Jesus. Huckleberry Finn may have said, well, faith is believing what you know ain't true. And many other folks will say things like that today. It's believing something there's no evidence for, but that is not biblical faith. You may remember back when they made good Indiana Jones movies. Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, there's a scene towards the end of that movie where Indy has to cross this chasm and find the Holy Grail and save his dad's life. And he doesn't know how to get across this chasm. He's just stood there, there's this massive gap, and he doesn't know what to do. He just knows he's meant to get across and that he has to. And so he starts to realize, okay, I need to have faith. And so he stands there saying, I must believe, I must believe, I must believe, I must believe, and psychs himself up into faith to put his foot in front of him. And lo and behold, it turns out there's a bridge there that was so camouflaged against the background you couldn't see it. And so many people think that's what faith is. It's summoning up some inner sense of belief that we've got to work ourselves up into. But that is not biblical faith. Biblical faith is based on reasons. And John shows us why we have faith in these verses. He specifically says our faith is based on the testimony of witnesses. And in verse 7, he says there are three. There are three that testify: the Spirit, the water, and the blood. So in verse 6, he begins by talking about the water and the blood. This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. Now, you will imagine lots of people have scratched their heads and gone, well, what's the water, what's the blood, what's he talking about here? The most likely explanation seems to be the water refers to Jesus' baptism and the blood refers to Jesus' death. Those were both events where it was made public that Jesus is the Son of God. When he was baptized, we had the voice of the Father proclaiming, this is my Son. At Jesus' death, the centurion says, surely this is the Son of God. Both those events were witnesses, the water and the blood. But then he talks about a third witness. He says, and the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. In other words, the Spirit testifies too, because it's the Spirit who brings the truth of these things to us, the Spirit who enables us to understand and to receive these things. It was the Spirit who led the apostles to record these events and write them down and explain them in the Gospels. Jesus had promised them that the Spirit would lead them into all truth, that he would help them remember, that the Spirit would help them to remember what they had seen and heard of Jesus. And the Spirit now helps us to see those things too. And behind all of that testimony of those three witnesses is the testimony of God himself. So verse 9, if we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. In other words, John is saying, listen, we believe other people all the time. I mean, we have to. You have to take people's word for it in life. And we do that all the time. We find ourselves daily believing the testimony of men. I won't be the only one who's come to the Lake District with a book of walks and hikes. And here are some routes to take. Here's a route up Skiddaw, here's a route up Helvellyn, and you follow the book. And the book says you park, go to this place, park here, exit through that gate, go up this path. When you get to the stile, hop over it, turn left up the stone wall, and so on and so on. And you trust it. You are receiving the testimony of men. We do it all the time. Hey, where are your facilities? Oh, they're down the corridor, down there on the right. Hey, does this have nuts in it? No, you're fine. We receive the testimony of men. And so we have even more reason to believe the testimony of God himself. And John says in verse 9, this is the testimony of God that he is born concerning his Son. God's testimony is that Jesus is the Son of God. And therefore, verse 10, whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. So what's going on here? When we hear or read of what Jesus has done for us in his life, his death, his resurrection, we are hearing the testimony of God. And so when someone comes up to me and says, well, you know, I'd like to investigate Christianity and I've got a bunch of questions, I'll say to them, great, I'd love to hear what your questions are, and that maybe that you want to find out a bit about the historical evidence, and there's resources to help you do that. But more than anything, I'll say to them, listen, if you've never read a gospel, you really need to. I'll help you answer the other questions that you have, but the best place to look to find out why you should think about being a Christian is to read a gospel. I want them to see Jesus in action themselves. And I'm thinking as they do that, they have an opportunity to hear the testimony of God. as they see the life and ministry of Jesus, as they see him turning to the leper and moving towards him in love and compassion, not recoiling from him, as they see Jesus responding so tenderly to those in distress, as they see Jesus challenging those who are being hypocritical, as they see Jesus laying down his life as a ransom for many, as they see Jesus raised from the dead and ascended to the right hand, I'm praying they will be hearing the testimony. The three witnesses behind which we have the testimony of God himself. So verse 11, and this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. The best way to be convinced of this is to read a gospel. And maybe even to pray. We've got nothing to do to lose by praying. I'll say to a friend, listen, why don't you read this gospel and just pray that God would show you that you can find life in his Son. If God doesn't exist, you've not lost anything by saying that prayer. But why not try that? Verse 12, whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have life. So the issue again is not, do you have faith? The issue is, what is your faith in? Occasionally someone will say, well, you know, I wish I had your faith, I just don't. And in most cases, what they mean is, you know, I'm not quite as simple and naive as you are. But it's kind of nice that you are. I'm glad you can believe these things. But some of us live in the real world. And I want to say, well, you do have faith. You're trusting in something to get you through the day. What is your faith in? And what are the reasons you have? Let me show you what my faith is in, and there are reasons for having that faith. So we have the sign that it's real, the evidence it's based on, and then thirdly, the assurance that it leads to. We looked at this verse on Monday. John says, verse 13, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. The gospel was written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. The goal of the letter is that you might know that you have eternal life. His aim with the gospel was evangelism. His aim with this letter is assurance. So he now ends this letter by outlining what we know because we believe, the confidence our belief gives us. And so he ends with a series of affirmations. And the first affirmations concern prayer. So verse 14, and this is the confidence that we have towards him. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. We now know we have the ear of God because of what his Son has done for us. One of my favorite pictures is an old photograph, a famous photograph of President Kennedy sat behind the desk in the Oval Office, working at the affairs of the country, whatever it is, doing a Sudoku, who knows. But sat there at the desk, busy working away, and underneath his desk is his little boy, John, just sat on the floor under the desk looking up at the camera. And it's such a beautiful picture because that man is the president. But there is someone who can toddle into that office and just sit on the floor under the desk and play. I can't think of another room on planet Earth that has more layers of security than the Oval Office. There are kings and prime ministers and presidents and big deals who don't get to just walk into that room. But a little toddler can. And it's as if, as he looks at the camera, he's saying, well, yeah, he's your president, but he's my dad. So I get to be here. And in Jesus, we have that same privilege. Jesus has opened up his sonship and folded us into it so that we now have going with God what Jesus had going with God. We can now approach God with the very same intimate confidence that Jesus did. We get to call God Abba, just as we heard Jesus call God Abba. Not because of what we've done, all because of what he's done. And so we know, because we come wrapped in the name of Jesus, that our Father hears us. It's why no prayer is ever wasted. There's never a bad time to pray. And more than knowing we're going to be heard, verse 15, if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests that we have asked of him. God wants us to ask of him. We're not bugging him when we do. I was reflecting with a couple of friends who are parents, and I was saying, you know, I love how the motivation to pray is that we have a father who loves to give good things to us. And it made me realize, you know, you parents, you love giving good things to your kids. You love it when they come to you asking for things and you think, yeah, I want to give that to you. And they said, yeah, there's a limit though. With human parents, there is a limit. If your child is coming up to you asking you for things every 10 minutes through the entire night, you are not equally receptive by the end of the night. That's not a function of you being a bad parent. That's a function of you being a real, actual human being. But God does not have the limitations that we have. Even that the biggest-hearted parent has a certain level of capacity beyond which they can't go. But we never exceed God's limits. We never wear him down. As my pastor loves to say, God is not tired, and he's not tired of you. He's the one person in the world right now who's not tired. And we don't need to worry about wearing him out with our prayers. He's not like us in that respect. All of us have limits. All of us can only cope with a certain number of people needing us for things. But we can know that God hears us and loves to answer our prayers. Now, John puts in that understandable caveat, we can ask anything according to his will. It's not that God is just a vending machine and we can, you know, whatever selfish thing we want, he will give us. He's a good parent, not a bad parent. Tim Keller once said that God will either give us what we ask for, or he'll give us what we would have asked for if we knew everything he knows. And it's a reminder that prayer is not about trying to twist God's arm to do what we want. It's not bending God's will to ours. Prayer is the way in which we bend our will to God's. It's why in the Lord's Prayer, Jesus begins by telling us to pray for the things of God before we ask him for our own needs. We pray for his name. We pray for his glory. We pray for his will. We pray for his kingdom before we come with our own needs and our own requests. And there's a particular area of prayer that John encourages us to pursue. In verse 16, John says, if anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask God, and God will give him life to those who commit sins that do not lead to death. So John is talking about sins that don't lead to death, and then says there is a sin that does lead to death. And again, it's one of these things people think, well, what's this distinction here? Sins that don't lead to death, sins that do lead to death. Well, most likely what John is talking about, the sin that does lead to death, is what he's been warning us about throughout this letter. It's turning away from Jesus. We know that's been going on. There are people who have walked away from apostolic Christianity. People who've evolved their understanding of who Jesus is so that it's no longer what the apostle said. And that's the sin that leads to death, because if we're not coming to Jesus and confessing him as the Son of God in the flesh, we can't receive life through him. John's just told us in verse 12, whoever has the Son has life. The sin that leads to death is the sin that stops us coming to the Son. It's the sin of rejecting him. So John says there is sin that leads to death. I don't say that one should pray for that. He's not saying you can't. But he seems to be suggesting that it is better to pray for those whose sin does not lead to death. In other words, if we think back to chapter 1, verse 7, how we walk in the light and confess our sins and be honest with each other, the more we start to do that, the more we understand where each other's weaknesses are, where each other's vulnerabilities are, we can pray for each other. I can think, okay, I know my friend is heading into this situation, and he's been kind enough to be honest with me about his own sins, and I know going into that situation is going to be tough for him, so I'm going to be praying for him. Praying that he doesn't sin. And if he does, praying that God would restore him. I'm very blessed to have a number of friends who very regularly pray for me. One of my Nashville mums sent me a message yesterday saying, we've been praying for you every day this week. And I know she does anytime I'm on the road. And I wonder how much sin I've been kept from because of her prayers. So we have confidence in prayer, and in the final few verses, John shows us we have confidence in our security in the Lord. Verse 18, we know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning. That's the point he was making back in chapter 3. He's not saying we can't sin. He is saying it's unthinkable that we would go on in sin, that we would make our home in sin, that would become habitual. He then adds in verse 18, but he who was born of God, Jesus, protects him, and the evil one does not touch him. We have protection in Christ. The evil one does not touch him. He cannot now lay a finger on us. It doesn't mean there's no temptation. Paul warns us in Ephesians chapter 6, that the devil is firing fiery darts at us. But it does mean that ultimately, the devil won't harm us. In contrast, verse 19, we know that we are from God, but we also know the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. So the evil one doesn't touch those who are protected by Jesus, but those who are in the world remain in his grip. And it's sobering to think that. It's why we long people would come to Jesus. But at the very least, we have security in Christ himself. I'm not looking at however many years I have ahead of me of being a Christian, however many years that happens to be. I'm not looking, thinking, yeah, I've definitely got it in myself to stay the course. No, I'm thinking, he who is born of God protects. God may give me more than I can handle. He will never give me more than Jesus can handle. And so I can have confidence. It's not down to my strength, it's down to Christ's. When someone says to me, hey, Sam, how's your Christian life going? I know what they mean, but in one sense, the answer is, not how's my week been, but how's Jesus doing? If Jesus is doing fine, actually, I'm okay. Well, verse 20, we have some final affirmations. John is in Twitter mode. We know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. We know the Son of God has come. It's hard to deny that. As I said the other day, his feet left footprints in the ground and his life has left footprints in history. We know that he's come. We know he's given us understanding. We know that we couldn't perceive who Jesus is unless God himself had given us understanding, unless that the Spirit had helped us to understand. Which means we can know that we do know him who is true. I might doubt everything else in this world, but I can be sure on this, that I know the one who is true. There's been various high-profile failings of Christian leadership in recent years. We've seen Christian leaders that we have revered, exposed to be people who were abusive, people who were unfaithful, whatever it might be. And one of the things that has given me such reassurance as we've gone through some of those scandals in different parts of the Christian world is to think there's no nasty hidden side to Jesus. There always is the potential for that with one another. But we will never discover some dark hidden side to Jesus. The only surprises we have in Jesus are good ones. He's even better than we thought he was. He's even kinder. We may know him who is true. And more than that, we are in him who is true. Isn't it reassuring to think that this Jesus I've now come to see, this Jesus I've now come to love and put my hope in, this Jesus is not, you know, at the other end of the universe, too far away for me to access. I am in him by faith. He has enfolded us into himself. He has come to dwell in our hearts, and we have come to dwell in his. We're united to him that profoundly. I never need to spend a waking moment of my life apart from Jesus. He himself said, surely I am with you to the very end of the age. And this is how he is with us. He's closer to us than we are to one another. He is the true God and eternal life. John then adds in verse 21, it feels like he ended the letter at verse 20 and then came back after a few minutes and thought, oh, forgot to mention idols. Verse 21, little children, keep yourself from idols. Right, okay, now I'm done. I knew I mentioned idols at some point. Now, that is not John sort of suddenly changing gear and going in a different direction. He's summing up actually what he's been saying to us all through the letter. Because of what he's just told us, why would we go after idols? An idol won't hear my prayers. An idol won't give me reassurance when my heart condemns me. An idol won't make me more loving towards you. An idol won't transform me and make me more like Jesus. An idol won't give me confidence as I think about what might happen after I die. No, when we realize that we know him who is true and that we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ, the true God and eternal life, we have nowhere else to go. I was talking with someone once, and someone who's not a Christian, and they were disagreeing with me about a particular ethical belief I have as a Christian, and they're saying, you just can't believe that today. I said, I know, I get that, I really do. But I said, you've got to know that I believe what I believe because I follow Jesus, and this is what he says. He said, we shouldn't follow Jesus then. I said, okay, tell me one thing. Tell me what you've got going for you that Jesus doesn't have going for him that would make me follow you in this area of life and not Jesus. He died for me and rose again. That's where the bar is currently set. If you can, if you can improve on that, I'm genuinely interested. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Because what have they got to offer us? What has anything else in this world got to offer us that can compare remotely to what we have in Jesus? So let me finish with where John began. John says in the opening verses, that which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, that you too may have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our and your joy may be complete. My brothers and sisters, may your joy be complete as you continue to look to Jesus. As you continue to look to the one who is the true God and eternal life. Let me pray. Our Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you for Jesus Christ. We praise and thank you that you have enabled us to understand that he is your Son. He is the one who is true, the one in whom we find real life and complete joy. Father, we thank you for the three witnesses. We thank you for the life and ministry of Jesus, his baptism. We thank you for his death and resurrection. We thank you that as we look at who he is and what he did, we can see that he is the Son of God. We can see that he is the Christ. And we thank you for opening our eyes to these things. Our Father, please keep us. Help us to keep ourselves. Help us to have assurance that we do have eternal life because our eyes are on Jesus. And for our friends around us, our communities around us, Lord, that might have some understanding of faith in some generic sense, but don't have any understanding of Jesus, we pray you would help us to bring others to him, that others might themselves find what we have stumbled into. Our Father, we praise you for him, and we pray in his name. Amen.
Let's stand and sing together about what it is we know is true.
Eternal Lord, is the Creator, forming all things by His word. I believe in our Lord Jesus, God's own Son who came to earth, born a man by the Spirit.
Just a joy to sing those words, affirming in our spirits what we've been hearing all week. Praise His name. Remember, there's a prayer team to my left, your right. Don't rush off from here if you've still got business to do with God. And just to assure you, we're praying for you all as you go back. Some of you will be traveling this afternoon. Go back to your homes and church situations, maybe some very difficult ones as well. And just to say, keep your eyes fixed on Christ. Keep the faith. And the more you keep the faith, you will realize that you are being kept. You are being kept. And this Jesus that we look to is kinder than we ever realized. And He will lead us safely home. And as you're being kept, share it wherever you go. Let's pray together now. Father in heaven, thank you for this rich feast that has been presented before us. Thank you for the beauty of your word. Thank you for the truth, that word that resonates throughout 1 John. Truth, truth. He is the truth. Help us to uncover lies because we're comparing them to the truth. And thank you, Father, that Jesus is the rock on which we stand today. Help us to go with confidence that we truly do belong to him, that he has us wrapped up in his love, and that he's going to take us to glory. And Father, as D.L. Moody says, one day I'm going to heaven, and I want to take as many people with me as I possibly can. Help us to leave on that note and be your priests in this world in which you've called us to live. Thank you for each other. Bless us now and all the traveling that's going to be happening today. God bless us. Keep us safe. In Jesus' powerful name, amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you.
Your love.